Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The partial government shutdown is now in its third week as the impasse over President Trump's demand for $5.7 billion in border wall funding shows no signs of abating over the weekend. Trump threatened to call a national emergency if no agreement is made.
We're looking at a national emergency because we have a national emergency. Just read the papers. We have a crisis at the border of drugs, of human beings being trafficked all over the world. They're coming through. And we have an absolute crisis and of criminals and gang members coming through. It is national security. It's a national emergency.
Democratic lawmakers swiftly condemned the idea, calling into question the legality of the move. Chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, Adam Schiff, called the idea a non-starter Sunday, saying, quote, if Harry Truman couldn't nationalize the steel industry during wartime, this president doesn't have the power to declare an emergency and build a multi-billion dollar wall on the border. On Sunday, Trump said he'd push for the construction of a steel barrier instead of concrete, presenting the idea as a compromise for Democrats. He also repeated the idea Mexico would pay for the wall through the USMCA trade deal, which would create billions in revenue for the United States. The USMCA has yet to be ratified by Congress. Federal agencies have been ordered to suspend planned pay raises for top administration officials amidst the ongoing shutdown. The raises had been set to go into effect on Sunday after a longstanding pay freeze for senior officials lapsed. 800,000 federal workers have either been furloughed or have been working without pay since the government shutdown started. The 380,000 furloughed workers will not receive back pay, and Trump canceled their January 1st raise. In Jerusalem, National Security Advisor John Bolton said U.S. military withdrawal from Syria would happen only after ISIS is defeated and if Turkey would guarantee they would not try to destroy U.S.-trained Syrian Kurdish fighters. Bolton's comments contradicted Trump's initial announcement from December 19th, ordering an immediate withdrawal and declaring the U.S. had won against ISIS. At a cabinet meeting last week, Trump also contradicted his December announcement, stating, I never said fast or slow. Bolton also said the U.S. would absolutely assure the security of Israel and other regional allies. Bolton set to meet with officials in Turkey today. While at a joint news conference with Bolton, the Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu called on the U.S. to recognize Israeli sovereignty over the occupied Golan Heights.
We'll go up to the Golan Heights, again, depending on the weather. The Golan Heights is tremendously important for our security. And I think that when you're there, you'll be able to understand perfectly why we'll never leave the Golan Heights and why it's important for that all countries recognize Israel's sovereignty over the Golan Heights.
Israel annexed the Golan Heights in 1981 after capturing the territory from Syria during the 1967 war, but the international community does not recognize its sovereignty. In November, the U.S. said it planned to vote against a U.N. resolution calling for Israel to end its occupation of the Golan Heights. In Yemen, a U.S. airstrike killed one of the suspected masterminds behind the suicide bombing of the USS Cole in 2000, which killed 17 sailors and wounded at least 40 others. Al-Qaeda militant Jamal al-Badawi was indicted on terrorism charges in 2003, but twice escaped prison in Yemen. The airstrike and al-Badawi's death, which reportedly occurred on January 1st, was confirmed Sunday in tweets by President Trump and U.S. Central Command. Meanwhile, Pentagon Chief of Staff Kevin Sweeney announced he was resigning Saturday. Sweeney's resignation comes just over 2 weeks after Mattis stepped down as Secretary of Defense, publicly rebuking Trump's foreign policy moves. He's the third senior Pentagon official to resign since Trump announced the U.S. would withdraw troops from Syria. Pentagon spokesperson Dana White also left her position last week. White was being investigated for ethics violations at the time of her departure. In France, the Yellow Vest protesters took to the streets again over the weekend. On Saturday, a group of protesters in Paris rammed a forklift into a government ministry building while violent confrontations between some demonstrators and police took place in the capital. A reported 50,000 people across France came out as the movement heads towards its second month of protests. On Sunday, hundreds of women organized their own yellow vest demonstrations in an effort to counter the recent violence and to highlight the economic issues faced by working women. This is protester Sophie Tissier.
There are thugs who slip into the protests, and they're mainly men. And we're telling them, we, the yellow vest women, want to do something peacefully, calmly. We are calling for our women's rights to protest and to take part in the struggle. It's very, very hard for women in this society. It's mainly us who look after the children. We have lower salaries than men. Lots are employed in unstable jobs. It's much harder for women in today's society. It's a lot more difficult.
Intercept is reporting that the Senate, in its first legislative act, will take up a bill that aims to prevent opposition to the Israeli government by allowing state and local governments to boycott any U.S. companies which are engaged in a boycott against Israel. The Combating BDS Act is part of multiple foreign policy measures contained in Bill S-1. It's sponsored by Florida Republican Senator Marco Rubio and is similar to, though reportedly less extreme than, a measure introduced last year by Democratic Senator Ben Cardin, where it was met with condemnation from free speech advocates. The Intercept reports 26 states currently have laws sanctioning entities which support a boycott of Israel, which can entail punishment of individuals working for employers subject to anti-boycott laws. Pope Francis appealed to Italy and Malta to allow a group of nearly 50 migrants aboard two rescue ships to disembark at their ports. The migrants have been stranded on the ships in the Mediterranean for 2 weeks, and leaders in Italy and Malta are refusing to let the boats dock. Pope Francis asked for the countries to show concrete solidarity to the migrants. Meanwhile, Spanish authorities say they rescued nearly 550 migrants at sea over the weekend. New clues are emerging in the mysterious case of U.S. diplomats in Cuba who experienced health problems after being exposed to an unidentified high-pitched sound in their homes. Scientists said Friday the high-pitched sounds released in a recording by the Associated Press were made by crickets rather than a sonic or microwave weapon, as some have speculated. In 2016, staff at the U.S. Embassy in Cuba began reporting unexplained symptoms, including hearing loss, dizziness, nausea, and memory loss, after hearing the sounds. Last month, doctors in Florida said the diplomats had suffered physical damage to their ears, though the cause of the damage remains unknown. The State Department withdrew much of its diplomatic staff from Havana and expelled Cuban diplomats from the U.S. following what they believed to be a targeted attack. In a rare move, the Justice Department acknowledged flaws and errors in a January 2018 report that linked terrorism and immigration. However, they are refusing to retract or edit the report. The report, entitled Protecting the Nation from Foreign Terrorist Entry into the United States, was released to support Trump's March 2017 travel ban barring entry to citizens from six majority Muslim countries. A man has been arrested and charged with capital murder over the killing last week of 7-year-old Jasmine Barnes in Houston, who was shot while in a car with her mother and three sisters. The suspect was originally believed to be a white man in a possibly racially motivated shooting, but police now say Eric Black Jr. was responsible in what's likely a case of mistaken identity. Police say Black was driving the car where the deadly shot came from. They apprehended him after receiving a tip from journalist Sean King. A second suspect is thought to be in custody, but his identity is yet to be confirmed by police. In Nevada, death row prisoner Scott Dozier died of apparent suicide Saturday. Dozier had been scheduled to die by lethal injection in July 2018, but a judge halted the execution just hours beforehand after a pharmaceutical company successfully sued to prevent the use of its drug, midazolam, to be used as part of a three-drug lethal cocktail. The cocktail would have also included the drug fentanyl. Dozier, who was convicted of two murders, had been placed on suicide watch after previous suicide attempts. He was found hanging from a bedsheet inside his prison cell. In Torrance, Southern California, three men were killed and four others wounded after shots were fired at a bowling alley late Friday night. The victims were identified as Aston Edwards, Robert Meekins, and Michael Radford. Police have not yet publicly identified any suspects. In South Carolina, two sheriff's deputies will be charged over the deaths of two women who drowned in a van that flooded during Hurricane Florence. 45-year-old Wendy Newton and 43-year-old Nicolette Green were in law enforcement custody at the time of their deaths after they had both gone to hospitals where they were involuntarily committed and detained. Joshua Bishop is charged with involuntary manslaughter, and Stephen Flood is charged with involuntary manslaughter and reckless homicide. You can go to our website at democracynow.org to see our coverage of this story. In Washington, D.C., a court of appeals ruled in favor of President Trump's ban on transgender people serving in the military. The decision overturned an earlier ruling by a D.C. federal judge blocking the policy for being unconstitutional. The ban, which seeks to restrict military service for transgender people who experience gender dysphoria, replaced an earlier ban on all transgender service members that was announced in July of 2017. Other injunctions against the ban are still in effect. The Trump administration has asked the Supreme Court to take on the case. In New York City, a trial kicks off today challenging the Trump administration's attempt to end temporary protected status, known as TPS, for 50,000 Haitians living in the U.S. Tens of thousands of Haitians were given TPS after an earthquake devastated Haiti in 2010. In November 2017, the Trump administration announced it would revoke TPS for Haitians. The move was met with protests and multiple lawsuits. In October, a federal judge temporarily blocked the Trump effort, which also affects immigrants from Sudan, El Salvador, and Nicaragua, citing a discriminatory motivation. Haitian TPS recipients and their supporters are expected to rally outside the Brooklyn courthouse today. And Indigenous land defenders in Western Canada say a raid on their encampments is imminent. Members of the Unist'ot'en and the Gidimt'en clan have been physically blocking entry to Native Wet'suwet'en territory, where TransCanada Corporation planned to build the massive $4.7 billion coastal gas link pipeline. Last month, a judge granted a temporary injunction for access by coastal gas link workers. Reports emerged over the weekend of chartered police buses arriving in the area to defy the two Wet'suwet'en roadblocks. This is Molly Wickham of the Wet'suwet'en clan speaking Saturday night.
You know, people like to think that things have gotten a lot better in so-called Canada and in our communities, and that things aren't the same that they were 150 years ago. But that's just a fallacy. It's false. Because we know right now in this reality that the state is willing and capable of using the same kinds of violence that they've used against our people for the last 150 years here.
Molly Wickham of the Gididim clan in Western Canada speaking Saturday night. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.